Today, there's no case on the at the WTO on disputes that involves local content requirement related to destructive sector. There is there are other developments in the renewable energy sector, but not in destructives. And so the question that we have asked our panelists and the experts in the E15 is whether the global trade and investment frameworks are really responding to these concerns and these objectives of generating sustainable development outcomes, and whether they are adequate or not, not only looking at how they've been used in the past, but the potential in the future. So in the panel, we have four excellent panelists. Let me introduce them one by one as we give them the floor. And I will start with Isabel Ramdu, who is the deputy head of the Trade and Economic Transformation at ECDPM. ECDPM is that one organization that competes with ICTSD in the difficulty of remembering the acronym, right? And that's why we like cooperating with them. They're well known to many of you, very active in the ACP countries. That's, I think, the origin of ECDPM. So Isabel has been looking at these questions for a number of years. She has produced research and analytical papers specifically on this question for us, as well as now for the OECD Development Center, I understand. And she will provide a general overview of the use and effectiveness, as well as questions regarding the improvement of transparency around these local content policies. So Isabel, you got the floor.
Okay, thank you very much, Ricardo, for the introduction. Good afternoon, everybody. I hope this is the first session after lunch. I hope you had a coffee, because the discussion is going to be, will need your attention. It's a very comprehensive technical subject. You bear with me if you hear names, words that look a bit barbarian. Ricardo introduced the topic already, so I'm not going to give you the context of local content and the reason why countries have increasingly in the last 10 years. So I'm not going to give more background about that, but the one observation that we have made is that over the last 10 years there has been an explosion and proliferation of policies in developing countries, or not only developing countries, in resource-rich countries. This is not a concern only to developing countries. As I will mention a little bit later, the approach is different, but the spirit, you find it all across the board. And that is an issue that actually came very prominently to the radar of the global policy agenda only in recent years, but it is not a new issue. Maybe I just want to mention a couple of words on the issue we're talking about, local content, two words, that there is no uniform definition. It can be interpreted very broadly or very narrowly. Both the word local has been particularly defined in certain contexts by certain types of stakeholders in a particular way. You can have a very narrow definition of local, that is suppliers or workers that are operating around the vicinity of a mine, or it can be more broadly defined. So we have an issue here about the definition of what we're talking about. The same for content. Content can mean many things. We generally associate it with the question of local procurement, sourcing of goods, and employment, but it can also cut across issues like transfer of technology, skills, know-how, downstream beneficiation, value addition. So it's a very broad concept. So I thought it would be interesting just to mention that at the beginning, because this means that the interpretation becomes very elastic and policymakers become very creative. So build onto what Ricardo was saying about the motivation of countries, the reason why, I think it's very important to mention that this is a very particular sector where there is on the part of a state, a resource-rich government, a political urgency to take more leadership. making sure that this finite resource delivers something for the future generation. I think that is one of the key drivers which makes the extractive sector very different from a textile sector, for instance, or any other renewable, maybe agriculture, whatever. You have something there that is going to end, and at some point in time you realize that you have to make something out of it, otherwise you're left with holes in the ground. So that is something. It makes the sector a strategic sector. Making it a strategic sector means that the political dimensions sometimes take a little bit over, and you need to find this balance between the political rationale, the economic rationale behind it, because there are real issues about employment, about being able to create linkages, disenclaving the sector. We very often hear that the extractive sector operates in an enclave, but you also have to make sure that your industries can thrive and survive. So it is a very delicate balance to find. And that brings me to the next point that I wanted to raise about the kind of approach that countries have taken to drive the local content policies. I want to also mention a statistic here, a few statistics here. 90% of resource-rich countries have local content policies. There is a study by McKinsey that came out recently that shows very clearly, it's a survey, but it gives you very interesting data. 90% of resource-rich countries, independent of whether they are rich, developing, big resource endowment, etc. That's a thing. The other interesting element with the data is that 93% of mining countries have local content policies in place, against 83% in the oil and gas sector. But if you look at the type of policies that countries put in place, whether it's very strict regulatory policies, the balance tilts in the favor of the oil sector. 50% of the oil countries have very strict regulatory policies, compared to only a third in the mining sector. So it's quite a very interesting. Local content policy is not new. Local content policy cuts across many things. The interpretation is broad. But the sector where you operate, some of them tend to be much more regulatory than incentives-based, which brings me to this way the policies are crafted. We observe these two trends. One is, which will be linked also to what we will discuss afterwards about the regulatory impact of it and the impact it has when you have agreements at the WTO, free trade agreements, bilateral investment treaties. Two types of approach come up very clear. One is the regulatory approach, which is really based on quantitative targets that are out there in the legislations, really binding commitments that government put in place, where the government really acts as a regulator, asking companies to abide to a certain number of targets, often based on volume or value. Just to give you some example, for instance, in Angola, 70% of the workforce, this is in the law, has to be local. Nigeria, I think, has the same in terms of procurement. In certain sectors, you have to procure exclusively from national, local suppliers. The same, for instance, if you take, again, in the oil sector, Indonesia, 30% of the contracts that are above 100,000 should be sourced locally. So this is a type of approach that many countries have taken. The other one, which is more subtle, just to add here, you have rules that set the targets, but you also have rules that set a direction, which is softer, still based in rules, but not targeted. Sometimes, if I take the case of Ghana, for instance, companies have to report every year the progress that they are making to meet. So reporting, justification, sometimes you have this agreement, which is there out without a specific target, but much more softer, and this is a kind of a gray zone. But you have this regulatory base. The other one, which is a bit more subtle and a bit, I would say, more general, and there's not enough debate about the impact of that. It's the incentives-based approach, basically to say that government, instead of acting as a regulator, they act as a facilitator. They give you incentives, provided that you buy from the source locally. So the mechanism is different. things like, you know, tax breaks or interest rate lower if you, you know, invest in a certain sector. So you do have this the other type of approach, which is probably much more widespread, that you see in many resource-rich developed economies that has crossed already a certain level of development. But the objective is the same, to source locally. The Australia has a Buy Australian Act that was, I think that lapsed a couple of, last year, 2013, which is very clear about local content, give you certain specific incentives if you buy local. Same. You know, in other areas, in the US, for instance. So just to say that, you know, there are different types of incentives, and this has an impact on the in framework in which you operate. Maybe I won't go into the details of what has worked or what has not worked, but just to say that, you know, the result is mixed. There has been some analysis out there that tried to assess to what extent those rules, regulatory base, have worked. The result is mixed. Just to say, it's very interesting, because which means that there is, you cannot conclude that local content policies are a good policy or a bad policy. What actually matters is how do you put it in place so that you don't create perverse incentives, you don't create, you don't breed inefficiency, you leave sufficient space for your local industry to grow, your investors, your mining companies. So it's a bit more complicated than, you know, good or bad policy. So quite interesting to see that, you know, the assessment out there is not a very clean picture. Extractive sector is one of the sector where you have a lot of interest, so, you know, bilateral investment treaties, FTAs, do make sure that, you know, if this is the interest, is captured out there. So it's not something that is, the legality of it is not only being carved within the multilateral system. So we looked both at those types of commitments that countries take. And it's very interesting because the WTO, the multilateral system, is very clear. You have some very specific rules at the WTO that talk to certain type of local content, maybe not all of them, some forms of them, just to give you, you know, I don't want to throw technical discussions in the room, but local content policies that are mandatory and rules-based and quota-related is totally prohibited. You are in breach of GATT Article 3, which is national treatment. You're in breach of the trade-related investment measures agreement. So it's very clear. But that doesn't cover everything. I was saying the WTO has very clear rules for certain types of local content policies, but many other types of local content policies are not covered. So there are a certain number of challenges that the current rule books have, and those challenges have, countries and governments trying to address it through the back door in the bilateral debate. And just to mention a few of them, one of them is the coverage, the comprehensiveness of local content, probably because there's no such definition. I mean, the definition is not clear. So, of course, you know, if you interpret it very broad, then the chance that you expand it and then you're out of WTO is... So the comprehensiveness, there's a lack of comprehensiveness in the coverage of WTO. The other thing is the enforcement mechanism at the WTO for existing rules. You don't want to be cynical, but, you know, there is a dispute settlement out there. You know, you can be in breach, but if nobody takes you to court, then so what? So, you know, this surveillance mechanism, this enforcement mechanism is a little bit weak. So this is something that has to be reinforced. And it has, at least on for extractives, actually countries or investors, by the way, I will go to this point later, but then they have turned to different mechanisms which are much more stricter to address that. Linked to the enforcement, maybe I should mention this one earlier, the surveillance mechanism, you know, transparency, what type of policies is out there? This is also, to me, where there are some weaknesses to be addressed. You do have notification and trade policy review mechanisms, but in my view, if countries don't notify everything, and sometimes the TPRM doesn't necessarily capture every sort of local content. So to me, this is also something that should be strengthened. The other point that I think is quite interesting when we think about how the disputes have been addressed by the bilateral is the dispute mechanism at the WTO, which is very fair. You have you go to dispute. If you're not happy, you get an appeal, etc. State to state, so state government-driven organizations, so governments will have to take government, except that, I was mentioning earlier, 90% of resource-rich countries have local content policies. If you live in a glass house, are you going to throw a stone on your neighbor? Not sure. So this is, to me, a weakness of the system. The way that thing relates to the dispute. Just to mention a final word, which is also linked to, and I'm speaking in 2 minutes on the bilateral investment treaty. We're speaking here about a sector where the investments are generally massive. You have multi-million dollar investments. It's not a small, SME or, little plant where if you have the financial compensation, there's no financial compensation if you go to the WTO and you're proved to have breached. There are other mechanisms to address that, but there's no financial compensation. And to me, this is one of the reasons that kind of tick to investors to go and look for a solution if they have been, asked to leave the country or if they have lost their license, because they won't have a financial compensation within WTO. And it makes the dispute settlement a little bit unattractive, I think. So just to say that these weaknesses have kind of led resource-rich countries, not only resource-rich countries, but countries that have an interest in natural resources, to look for alternative regulatory solutions elsewhere through the bilateral routes. Two types, basically, of bilateral routes that have been used. One is the free trade agreements. Free trade agreements, especially the new generation of free trade agreements that came, I would say, after NAFTA, have clauses on investment that are much more restrictive. I just take the case, some of them are not, extremely deep. I just take the case of the Economic Partnership Agreement that was... statements that are it's what we call negative list. So it's a different approach, which means that it is something that looks very attractive to investors, especially if you're dealing with countries where the governance is relatively weak. You don't have systems in place in the country to give this guarantee. Just to mention, one of the things under the bilateral investment treaties that make them extremely popular is this investment state dispute mechanism, where basically the investor can take the states to court and win, get compensation for it with a plus. So you can imagine if you have a big investment involved, that's kind of route that you might end up with. Just a point, Ricardo was mentioning earlier that there has been no dispute settlement cases under extractives on local content at the WTO. Interestingly, under bilateral investment treaties, 25%, one out of four case is on local content and extractives. It shows you, the system, the systemic issues we have. So then how do we move forward from here? When we were discussing during the E15, we were thinking about potential proposals that we could make to the WTO, but also more broadly. I'm not going to talk about the broad picture, but I just wanted to mention two things where... And then the multiple form of regulatory mechanisms, on the other hand, creates real systemic issues to the system. And that I think it is really very important to make sure that we have something at the global system that works. We came up with a couple of proposals. Some are very ambitious, otherwise others are very specific on all the issues that Ricardo mentioned. I'm going to only talk about local content now, but. Two things came out. One I was mentioning earlier, I think this is probably the lowest hanging fruit. It's the question of the surveillance mechanism at the WTO that should really be strengthened. I think we need to make sure that at least starting point we have an understanding of what local content is. This is to me the root cause of the problem why we have discussions like this today, because people interpret local content differently. That's not an understanding. If you look at the WTO rules, you have understanding of many things. So it would be, I think, useful to have, once and for all, an understanding of what are we talking about, what is it that the WTO can do, and what is it that the WTO can't do. That's one thing. The other thing about transparency, I was mentioning earlier that there are 25% cases out there, the BITs that cover... bilateral investment treaties. Nobody knows what they are. So it is very important, to have transparency, also to make sure there is cooperation on that. I just wanted to mention two things maybe on the effectiveness on the system and what is it that we can propose to improve the system. The Minister Plumman was mentioning in the plenary earlier this morning the question of the investment agreement. I actually think this is a very good idea. Even if, we know very well, and she was very diplomatic in saying that it was a very difficult topic. If you look at the way things have been running in parallel, just look at the figures. Number of countries that have concluded bilateral investment treaties, what type of countries they are, whether how rich they are in resources, there is a correlation there. Actually, countries are not interested in having an investment agreement, but they are signing extremely complex, extremely restraining agreement in the bilateral. So having something which is a bit like the GATS, something that is very flexible, that allows you actually to negotiate the type of flexibility that would suit the needs of developing countries, to me, is something that is very important. And then alternatively to that, if that is something that might not work, you can also think of having a sectoral agreement on natural resources, because it's a finite resource. You can have something that is specific enough to have an agreement that will, craft the contours of exactly what you can, what you want to regulate, and in what way you can make sure that you meet the different goals that Ricardo were referring about for the developing countries, for resource-rich countries, for the global system, etc. I'll just stop here because I know I've been running a bit over time.
Well, Thank you very much, Isabel. That's very comprehensive, but not only that, very precise, including on the proposals. And as you said, these are just two of the proposals. You call them low-hanging fruit. They're very complex to carry forward, particularly because of the politics and the political economy. But let's go immediately to Babajide Sodipo. And Babajide is the regional trade advisor at the African Union Commission. He's been working again on these issues for many years. Has also participated in the E15 on extractives, as well as following some other groups. So Babajide, I'll just go straight to you to provide us a bit more of details in the African context.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. And I think I'll definitely like to thank Isabel for her presentation. I think she has spent a lot of time in the really technical, boring, somewhat aspects, so that, you know, at least our own presentations can focus a little bit more on the strategic side. I've been asked really to discuss local context in the context of the African and the African Union's experience. Let me start first of all from a very big picture. What do African countries want? Right? They want to develop. I think that one is better. Right. Thank you very much. So what do African countries want? They want to develop. They want to lift the vast majority of their populace out of poverty, move up the development indices, sustainable development goals, and so on and so forth. What do most African countries have? Most African countries have a lot of natural resources, which in certain ways they can transform into wealth to improve their lives, the lives of the citizens. However, in the past couple of decades since African countries have been independent, why has it been that in spite of this rich and great endowment of natural resources, the living standards of the people haven't really moved much? Why do we have this narrative about the resource causes, where you find out that some of the countries that actually have the richest deposit of natural resources tend to be some of the poorest? Of course, the narrative is full. There are a number of issues involved, including governance, corruption, you know, maybe historical issues, and so on and so forth. But one consistent theme that economists and other actors do tell African countries is that in order for you to improve, in order for you to develop, in order for you to be able to use or maximize your natural resources effectively, then it means you need to be able to retain more of the value of the natural resources that you have. I think generally we can all agree that this is a legitimate objective. I've not been in any meeting or in any discussion where you'll find either a partner or an investor or, you know, civil society or anyone for that matter making the argument that it is not legitimate for not just African countries but for a resource-rich country to try to maximize the value of its resources. So let us, first of all, at least understand that, yes, in the context of local content policies, what African countries, as very and other resource-rich countries, are trying to achieve, right? The overall objective is a legitimate objective, and it is legitimate on so many reasons. Nobody can argue with that. Now, beyond the legitimacy of this objectives, as described by Isabel, there are a number of factors that make the use of local content policies, you know, compelling for countries that are resource rich. I think she cited the statistics of 93%, 88% in certain cases, where virtually every country that has had that has natural resources, whether developing or developed, has in one form or the other used or uses local content development policies. Why is that? I think the very first rationale, which again is reinforced in the African context is that it is such a it's a political no-brainer, really, for politicians to use local content policies. Even if you look at the phrase local content, it doesn't sound bad or negative like maybe exports prohibition, you know. Because local content, you're thinking local development, local voters, you know, all politics is local. So even if you tell or you introduce the topic to a politician for the first time that let us use local content policies, you know, he's going to shake his head, nod his head because it sounds very intuitive. I'm going to make the local people happy. Why can't I do it? What's wrong with it? You know? So it makes sense for the politicians. It also makes sense for the opposition politicians in the sense that if you're not doing using the natural resources for the populace, then it's very easy for the opposition to say that, okay, he's working for the outsider. You know, he has been co-opted by the mining company or by the mineral resources company. Then really, how do you expect the policymaker or the politician that has to make a policy, how do you expect him to react in that sense? So first of all, there is the political reality that local content policies are just very easy, very intuitive, very natural for policymakers to implement. So that's one reason why it's consistent along the board. There are also the social reasons. If you take the example of Nigeria, the Niger Delta issues, I think as part of the lead up to the local content law in Nigeria, you had quite a bit of agitation in the Niger Delta. You had kidnappings, you know, vandalization. It is easy to say that, okay, you know what? I'm going to be exploiting this oil or this resource in your area. I'm going to employ half, you know, the majority of the people that will be working there will be from your populace, so that you are equally invested in it, so that if it fails, you don't see it as your failure, you see it as our failure. So again, it becomes an intuitive social engagement approach for any company to take. And even in a lot of countries where you have multiple levels of government, the resources is usually controlled at the national level. Then you find this local content policies, as I think it was described in Isabel's paper, where in order to make the kind of political accommodation within the federation, you need to give the people of that area something tied to the resources so that they won't cause problems, and, you know, they won't start kidnapping or burning down your mine and this kind of things. And again, in the context of democracy, in the context of civil engagement, it is a perfectly legitimate thing to do. Co-opt the people into it, make them invested, and all that. And then even in terms of the economic sense, I think for any mine operator or for any, you know, oil operator, if he can, the more of its produce or the more of its content that it can source from the locales, so to say, to the extent that it is reasonably competitive or reasonably efficient, in the long run, it makes more business sense to get a caterer from the area or from the nearby village than to import a caterer from Geneva or from wherever. So there is, again, that economic rationale. So then you ask the question then, that given all this, as how much sense it makes, then why shouldn't politicians or why shouldn't policymakers instinctively think of using local content policies? And then you come to the point that for law to be effective, right, for people to feel that it is equitable, it has to make sense in terms of what you're trying to achieve. So some of the arguments you do hear about local content, against local content, is that yes, it distorts the market, it does this, it does that, but you're not going to engage with a policymaker that, okay, you can't employ the people from your area because it distorts some, you know, graph somewhere. You know, it's just probably going to laugh you out of the room, or it's not even going to give you the time of day. So the question then is, what is the alternative to local content policies in terms of creating value in in countries or resource-rich countries. What else can you tell the minister to do? Because if you're going to tell him that the WTO or a bilateral investment treaty does not allow him to do this, you should be able to tell him what he can do to achieve the same objective. And in reality, it's a difficult thing. The simple objective he wants is that he wants more people from that area to be employed in the mine. How else can he do it without having some kind of, whether incentives or punitive approach to enforcing local content? And until the conversation, first of all, agrees that the objectives behind the policy are legitimate, and that, okay, if we have agreed on the legitimacy of the objectives, these are the alternatives to not using local content to achieve the same objectives, then the use of local content is never going to reduce. It's just going to keep spreading, because with deep conviction, nobody believes it's a bad thing, right? Other than the fact that some international agreements say you can't. And what happens? Beyond the fact that nobody has challenged in the WTO, a number of the countries that have had really bad experiences in the bilateral investment treaties, this has actually even pushed some countries to either completely renegotiate the international agreement or step back from it and say, you know, okay, I'm not going to be a partner in the international process if it means that I can't use local content policies. And I think the discussion must acknowledge the way that the policymaker in a resource-rich country sees this thing. So in terms of the future of local content policies, I think some of the points Isabel raised, there just needs to be more slack. There really isn't any point in having an international rule that nobody really agrees with, or that people are just looking for the most convenient way to avoid it. Then what value really is there? Who benefits from it other than perhaps the arbitration lawyers that benefit from these things and so on and so forth? And nobody's really going to hold a flag in their favor when you start having this discussion. So there is a necessity that for the rules to maintain credibility, it has to reflect the context of life. Otherwise, when you start having the engagement with policymakers from resource-rich countries about local content, then it devolves into an argument about, okay, you are telling me how to use my natural resources, this is no longer colonialism, and everything goes downhill from there. It becomes an emotive issue, simply because insofar as the policymaker is accountable to his civilians, to his population, he has to do that otherwise, because that's the whole point of accountability. He's not there to make Shell or, you know, a big mining company happy. He's there to make the population happy, and if they demand it, then he has to find some way to deliver it. And it is not a sufficient excuse to win re-election to tell them that, you know, the WTO said I could not do it, you know, that's why I didn't do it. It won't win him the next re-election. And I think one of the interesting points that one of the challenges, of course, has always been that there has been limited capacity to do these things. And the discussion should be more about how can we effectively design local content policies that will achieve the purpose with the minimum amount of restrictions or with the minimum amount of damage. The conversation should not be about whether or not we need local content policies. And I think some of the points made about regional content in Isabel's paper is quite interesting in terms of pooling together resources within a particular area or particular geographic zone so that they can achieve that result. I think I've exhausted my time, but I'll just leave it there for now. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Babadija, and particularly for being very, if you allow me, non-politically correct and just very frank about how these issues are played out in the policy arena. Let's turn now to Ana Escobedo. Ana is the Director of International Government Affairs at ArcelorMittal. At the global level, she takes care of these kind of issues.
and represents the group as well. And you've been studying these issues for a long time. So you were also part of the E15. So welcome, Anna. You got the floor.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. Thank you very much, Isabel. I'm going to talk from the mortality of the private sector. And I would like you to play the roles with me, because the eyes of the private sector are not against anything that has been said here. It's just that we happen to have some stakeholders that have very clear mandate to us, which is create profits for them. So let's just imagine we have the government of our developed country, the Minister of Industry, that happens to be also the Minister of Extractives. Let's imagine we have a private company which have stakeholders, shareholders. I think what Babajit said, it's key. The government, what they want with these type of remedies is to look for solutions to help the development of economy. What companies like us are looking for is how to cover the costs to develop our projects. So, how can a government interact with a company like ours to fulfill both of the needs? Because we will not be able to invest if we cannot cover our cost and report to our stakeholders. He will not let us invest if we cannot give him what he needs. Additionally, nowadays, what we have seen locally is that even if he doesn't think about local content, as soon as one of our employees of the companies put a foot on the ground, the communities are going to ask, so, you're going to dig a hole here. What is there for us? You are going to take part of the land that belong to our ancestors. What are you giving to our economy? So even if sometimes local content is not regulated on the national scheme, it is more and more often negotiated with the local communities. More and more there's argumentation or integration on the sustainability policy on the company, on how the integration or the at the end of the day, it's almost like a marriage. You are there to operate a long term with the communities. So this is the framework I would like you to keep. Now, let's think about what Mr. Babajit said. What are the options? Maybe in the past, governments used to operate the projects. They were owners. They did some build, operate, transfer contracts with companies, like in Mexico in the energy sector or in Middle East. So they would take the profits and they would distribute it or do whatever they think with the communities. Many cases that didn't work. We could see that Petrobras, that they changed the model. So one of the solutions that the government found is these tools that would allow them to integrate the benefits of what this project or tender creates and match what the companies does with what the local economy needs. So this is the first point I want you to keep in mind. We are talking about collaboration. If the government comes and puts straightforward requirements, the company might not be able to fulfill. So we need a bit of a stick and carrot approach. You are asking me from one side, let's assume in a developing country or a least developed country, to invest $2 billion, $3 billion, which 60% of it is going to go to infrastructure, maybe 30% of it is going to be to the project itself. Plus, I need to take care of local context. So how does it work? Then the government is going to think, yes, you are right. You are doing a huge investment that is not going to impact directly my local economy, but is required for making this project work. That's what we call, again, collaboration. A second point that I think we have seen also locally as a worldwide company that we do mining and steel, the requirements of local content has to be balanced. When you ask a company to hire locally and there's no capacity or capability on the local employment to provide the requirements that the company needs, the company has a problem. So there has to be an understanding as I think Isabel clearly defined, how do you do a quantitative measure or a qualitative measure? Many countries are talking more about training before telling local staff. More and more we are moving into local staff. Countries are I would say, in more and more using the scorecards, like in the case of South Africa, that there is a clear mandate, and it's not only extractive, it's worldwide. More and more we are seeing that elements on equity in many of the extractive industries. South Africa is a good example. Indonesia is a very good example. This also allows empowerment of the local communities. It has its plus and its weaknesses. What we also have to take in consideration regarding supply chain, which is linked to a local procurement, is you are creating an artificial demand. So if this supply chain is not efficient, does not generate a competitive opportunity in the process that is supplying this project, this industry is not going to survive. The government needs to understand that. You cannot implement this regulation and subsidize artificially industries that as soon as the economy develops, they will not have a market. That is when I come into the element of the long-term vision of the government. There has to be a clear view on what we call, I would not say industrial policy, but I would call it industrial program. Developing an industry like I don't know how you call the fish that are on top of the sharks that live on the osmosis of the shark. As soon as the shark dies, the little fish will die as well. So you have to develop an industrial policy that allows eventual independence of your domestic industry. I would also like to raise another point which local content or supply chain brings in domestic economies. They increase pricing. Because what happens? You are increasing my costs for operating. Then I'm going to increase my price, which means that if I'm not able to allocate my product, then I'm not able to compete, which means either you help me one way or another, or my project will not survive. That means that the government is going to say, okay, someone is going to jump here. Okay, I'll put some export restrictions. And we will have an impact on the local economy. Yes, the industry is developing. Wow, we have now transformation industry. This is great. Okay, yeah, you have export restrictions and you have some challenges there because you might be artificially making a distortion in your own economy. I'm not saying that's wrong, that's right. We operate in every environment and we adapt. But it has to be considered. I would say then, there has to be also an understanding, as I mentioned, the development element. And this is why the long strategy of governments is key. Let me develop a bit further. We produce iron ore. We are a mining company. We are also a steel company. We sell it to transfer pricing to our other operations around the world or in the same country. Let's assume Canada. We have mining operations in Quebec. We have steel operations in Ontario. But we also have mining operations in the north, in the Nunavut region, which there's nothing. There's only ice there. So what happens if the Canadian government does not understand how the steel industry works, and they start putting elements on their mining industry that blocks the development of the steel industry in their own country? That means that our operations in Canada are going to start bringing iron ore for Australia. Might be cheaper. This is a bit of the game that I want you to understand how local content works. We companies adapt. Either we close, or we move, or we pass the price, or we talk to you and negotiate. And this is where we come to, as I was saying, a bit the longer term, and how we link it to what Isabel was calling the international framework or the WTO elements. I would like to bring a similar concept, but from the other side, which is rules of origin. What's the difference? Well, rules of origin is a tool to help your local supply. Local content is a tool to promote local investment. At the end of the day, both distort. One is more regulated than the other. One might be applying in the higher supply chain or higher developed industries. But at the end of the day, for me as a steel industry that I produce in Canada, I do welcome rules of origin. I do not welcome that the rules of origin that they apply in Canada are totally different from the rules of origin applied in Europe. And I do not welcome that whatever I have to fulfill in the NAFTA region is totally different what I have to fulfill in Brazil. So at the end of the day, this also has a parameter on what we are talking today on the local content. Which gives me also to, let's say, my latest remarks, which is how governments define local content and the need for flexibility. I don't think, and I hope really not, that we will get to a recipe and then you're going to find a very nice report that says, oh, to be successful, apply this approach on training, apply this scorecard, an equity approach, etc. Because each country needs something different and is only also based on how do you develop your industrial program. So I'm just going to, let's say, list one of the learnings, or a few of the learnings that we have felt in our different programs. There has to be a very wide strategy of value-added creation and competitiveness. You cannot just add local content without consequences overall your economy. You really need to understand what you're doing overall, the different sectors involved. It has to be transparent and backed by strong and accountable institutions, which is what Isabel was mentioning. If the WTO, okay, they can define what local content is, but also they can help identify the different tools. They have to be realistic on the targets. You cannot think that local content is going to make a full development of your parallel industries. The shark dies, the little fish would die. I don't think, well, it is pretty much linked that the formulation and of the policies are not to be the main target. The main target is the development of economy and the subsistence of the project. And I guess what we call the golden rule, government should only, or regulatory should only give priority to local procurement when they are able to provide local procurement. Don't push companies to buy if they don't have the chances to cover it. Thank you.
Again, thank you very much for that, Anna. And as with the previous two speakers, for being very frank from your perspective about these issues, I think you've been very clear about sort of the relevance of local content and other policies and their legitimacy, but on the proviso that they don't undermine competitiveness and they countries don't shoot themselves on the foot, so to speak. So let me turn to our fourth speaker in this panel, and that's Patrick Obat. Patrick did not participate in the group of the E15 initiative on extractives. And so what we had hope is that he would react to what has been said here, and specifically from his perspective as the executive director of the Kenyan Extractive Industries Development Program. So coming from a Kenyan oil industry perspective. Again, so Patrick, you've got the floor.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. It's normally difficult to speak after so many people have spoken about local content. But what I bring to the table is more or less our experience in Kenya in terms of trying to develop local content in a nascent industry. Mining in Kenya has basically been artisanal, and in the last 10 years or so, there's been this baby steps that have taken a long time in getting a large titanium mine going in the country. There's a lot of interest in terms of at the exploration and mining in different parts of the country that are going on now. And with the discovery of oil in Ghana and then in Uganda, then a lot of interest came into Kenya as well, and effectively oil was discovered in Kenya. Now that's more or less the overall large perspective. But when you look at where we are as a country, first of all, the legislation is following the discovery of the resource. So it is trying to answer questions that are being raised on a very high expectation platform already. And why high expectation? When you look at resource exploitation, the conversations that happen on a national basis are around the level of investments that are going to take place in the resources. Now, when you hear the kind of money that is being talked about, and that then translates across the complete governance structure in a country, with the national government, the county government, down to the communities, each one receives that in a different way, and the expectations are built in a different way. Now, when you talk about putting legislation in place and talk about local content, you are trying to address all these different recipients of this investment figure. And they build expectations that sometimes are actually out of proportion, because that investment figure is not going to be recovered very quickly. It's something that is going to be recovered in 15, 20 years, or maybe even longer in some of the investments. So that by the time the benefits or potential benefits begin to accrue and flow down, it may be 6 to 8, 10 years from the time the first investment decision was made. So within that period of time, what do you tell all the people who heard about all these expectations? So when you try and put local content into that context, it means that the conversations that have to start around local content need to be tempered very carefully. And some of the work that we've done basically is in trying to look at how do you manage expectations at the beginning? How do you engage government? How do you engage the county governments? And a lot of countries in Africa and in other places have got regional governments. And each of them has got an expectation as well. And also, how do you avoid making the same mistakes that other people have made? When the contacts that the local communities have and the information they have is based on don't make the mistakes that were made in Nigeria, don't make the mistakes that were made in Chile, and so forth and so on. That is what you get. So you've already got a very highly charged local community that you're going to be talking to when you go in as an investment organization. So when you talk about working with local content, I think one of the best ways to frame it is to move away from the fact that the impact is going to be as a result of the investment alone. The conversation should be turned around the other way completely and look at the development needs of the local community, of the local government, and of the national government and say, fine, this is where you want to go as a country, as a local community, and work out the development imperatives that are required first and then look at how you're going to fund it. Now, if you go to a local community and you say, fine, you know, what is your development going to be? And they hear oil is coming, they'll say, no, we want the money from the oil to develop us. But if the discussion is around what is it that the community needs to become sustainable, that is defined first. And then you say, where's the money going to come from? And that money is going to come from oil, from gas, from mining. It could be from a whole host of other opportunities. That conversation removes the tension that we are currently seeing in a lot of areas where you've got resource exploitation with the local communities. I think the other thing around local content and resource utilization is what Ricardo said at the very beginning, capturing value. A lot of the conversations that happen at the national and regional level is around, again, money coming into the economy. But if you talked about saying, how can we add maximum value using the resource that is being taken out of here, then you have a different conversation with the investors, and with the people who are coming in into the supply chain as well. And if you take, for example, in Kenya, we are having oil, or we'll have oil at some point in time. The discussion is about exporting it. Well, what about if the discussion was around how can we not avoid building a pipeline to export it? How can we actually go around adding value such that it is value-added commodities that go out of the country rather than oil alone? When that discussion takes place, then the opportunity for benefiting the economy is much bigger. But unfortunately, these discussions do not take place in the context of a single country. It has to take place on a regional basis because of the volumes involved. And if you look at the East African context, it means that Kenya, Uganda, South Sudan have got to talk together. Because to make the maximum value addition, you need the production of all the three countries together of oil to make that happen. That then brings in a very complex political dimension, because every country wants to be in charge of its own resources and say it is ours and we are doing this by ourselves. But that does not create the economies of scale that allows maximum value addition. So again, with governments, the discussion has to be around how can you extract maximum value rather than purely talking about exporting the resource outside. I think we all know about the issues that developing countries had agriculturally in the 60s and 70s when we used to export coffee and import instant coffee back into the country. Value was being added somewhere else. We need to have a different discussion now and talk about not going to exporting the crude oil and everything else and then bringing in product, because we are going back to the 60s when we used to export coffee and get back instant coffee. We need to be able to say we are going to start talking about getting fertilizers out of that, which then can help the local economies. So you're thinking in a different way and having a much better impact rather than focusing purely on local content as the game changer in the country. So local content is still the conversation that is taking place now. So how can we make it work for us? The first thing I think we've got to do as local content is to agree on the path with the investors who are coming in and the people who are going to benefit in the country about how do we begin to transfer knowledge and technology. There's got to be a process. It's not about legislating and saying this is what we want. If you take an example of what happened in the northern part of Kenya, during the exploration period, there's a lot of intrusion into the community. And at that point in time, the community says, we want employment immediately. The rig will come in and stay there for a month, 2 months. So yes, you get local employment and then you demand high wages. The rig then moves on to another place. So the people who are doing certain things locally, you know, day-to-day basis, have now tasted what you call the power of being employed. And therefore, they will not want to continue what they're doing, but there's no more employment because the rig has moved on. So they'll follow the rig. But what happened in reality was that the next local community said, you guys can come here. This is for our own local people. So again, you begin to create conflict purely by just trying to manage expectations on a local basis. But the communities will say, no, ours is basically, we have to have our own local, very, very local stuff. So I think the issue of local content has got to be managed very, very carefully. There's got to be some very clear communication with all the local communities and the counties to explain what we call the resource journey. Because the resource journey is not very much understood by a lot of communities or even regional governments. Because if you look at mining, for example, by the time you've done your initial exploration, you manage to find out the size of the resource, and then you begin to mobilize people to come in, that's quite a long time. In the meantime, people still have to live the way they've lived. But then when the mine comes in, and this is the difference between oil and gas, a mine will come in and it will actually be with you in the local community and in your face for the next 20 years. Mm-hmm. So it's going to really transform the way you live. But once the mine is abandoned or the abandonment process takes place and all the remediation is taking place and everything else, what will be left? And if you don't design that on day one,
and deflect that from relying 100% on the mine, you will have a very, very big social disaster at the end of it, which you can't expect a mine to do. But having designed a sustainable intervention that can last beyond the mine, that is much better. With oil and gas, it's different. You have a lot of intrusion at the beginning, but at the end, the oil disappears down the line, and you won't see it. So effectively, the community will be left with this pipeline that is sitting there, and the resources coming out, but there's no employment. So again, the impact of that has got to be discussed and understood, that the opportunities are going to be much further away than local. Because oil production, basically, you have a few nodding donkeys and a couple of pumps, and that's it, and a pipeline going away. If that isn't done effectively, you will have what happened in the Delta in Nigeria. The local community will come and drill holes in the pipe to get attention. And then you have to come and explain to them, and if you don't satisfy them, they'll drill more holes. And so you're creating a sort of an escalation of a problem, whereby now you have pollution, you have all sorts of other things happening, purely because the quality of conversation you had at the beginning was not right, and the people did not understand. This is to talk about maximum value addition. That's the first thing. The second thing is to talk about sustainable interventions that are not 100% dependent on the resources themselves. Because once they're finished, you'll be left with nothing. But the resources should be utilized to actually fund the sustainable intervention, not the resources themselves being the intervention. Because that way, you then end up much better as a country. And I think the third thing is to think big and do maximum value addition locally. Then the issue of local content becomes a much bigger discussion, and it becomes less emotive than just looking at the small bits and pieces of empowering small companies and so forth to actually just pick a few crumbs. I think we need to change the narrative and make it a much, much bigger conversation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Patrick. That was excellent. And really a sustainable development perspective in a very big way. I think we have about 10 minutes, I think, that we can go over, because we started late. And I'd like to just give the floor to the audience. So if you could just identify yourself as you take the floor. So can I take you first, and then gentlemen here, and then we'll go to the two of you, please.
My name is Jeff Geipel with Engineers Without Borders. And I want to applaud not only your remarks now, but also in the last session. I think they're blunt, but they're fair, and I think they're sort of actually coming from a good place of trying to help. I guess my question is, I wouldn't consider you the norm in the industry, and how do we bring other companies along this ride of actually being a little more constructive? I think companies like yours and Anglo-American, they seem to come from a good place trying to work with governments to do this, whereas a lot of other governments just sort of write it all off as this is all bad regulation and that kind of thing. And I would say the same thing for the people at the plenary just now. I mean, that was very, very blanket unbalanced, I think, whereas what you're saying is we need a balance between regulation and free trade. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
Thank you. Let's just let's continue that conversation on that balance, because that will be fun too. Yes.
Thank you. My name is Frank Mjenya. I'm from African Union Commission. I just want to thank the panelists, and I think they have all they articulated issues. I think between Babajidi and the lady from Anna. You all are talking about the same thing. I think Babajidi made a point to say it has to make business sense. If it doesn't make the business sense, then it doesn't really. And we're talking about social contracts. And I think even Patrick just brought out the same thing. Although he concentrated on local, but eventually he came out to come to local, national, local, regional. So I think what we are trying to say is actually what you said, carrot and stick and carrot. And Isabel also brought should we take the punitive measures, or should we actually allow you to negotiate? But also to know that while you are looking at maximization of the of your stakeholders and shareholders, the governments are also trying to maximize the interests of their shareholders, who are the communities and the development. So when you invest that billions and you are using 60% for infrastructure, is that infrastructure multi-user, multi-purpose? Is it for the government? Is it a road? Is it a hospital that is going to be for everybody? Or are you looking at social corporate responsibility? Sometimes it is voluntary, and what comes out of it may not be beneficial to the community. So how do we ensure that what you're actually putting forward is for development, not for local and just leaving a shark to die and then the small ones fish? But how can we make those fish continue to survive even after the shark has died? Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Just over here, the two of you, please.
Thank you. I'm Ari from Indonesia. And it was a very interesting to hear from all of the panelists this afternoon. First of all, I realized that, as mentioned, there is a need to find a balance between political and economic rational or collaboration between government and the private sector. But in Indonesia itself, I can say that it's growing to be a big public discourse. It is not only a conversation between government and the private sector, but also a conversation between the government, the bigger public, the academia, and the NGOs. Everybody's writing about this on national paper, and we heard about, and academia keep on writing papers citing that Brazil doesn't have any BITs and they're fine with investment on extractive industry, and then national media keep on putting headlines that the state is being sued by extractive industries for billions of dollars and we have to pay, things like that. So it's a very big public discourse in Indonesia. And so the conversation should not be between government and the private sector. I mean, the notion in public is that the interests of investors should not triumph over public policy consideration. So now, in a democracy like Indonesia, with decentralized democracy, you know that even sometimes some government could be brought to the corruption trial just because they hand on some contract for extractive industry that is wrongful or something like that. So there is this need to make sure that we don't have any. We have a lot of, like, Indonesia decide to put an end all of our BITs, and then we have some local content requirements which are more regulatory approach than incentives approach, because we think that the government needs to be on the side of public consideration instead of the investors' interest. So we don't have any intentions to undermine our competitiveness, and we're not trying to shoot ourselves in the foot. It's not the case that the government doesn't know how the industry works. We know how the industry works. It's just that sometimes the government hands are tied. So what kind of policy could be taken to bridge the gaps in calculation and consideration of decision making between the governments and the private sector? Because it is not only about the government and the private sector, but with a lot of stakeholders and actors. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. My name is Kwesi Obin. I'm from Tax Justice Network Africa. I'm based here in Nairobi, a Pan-African research organization. Well, I mean, I think two things. Isabel and Baba made two important points about local content. But I just wanted to refract that in just why it's picked up over the last decade or so. Because even though, as the two of you made, it's been around with us for so long, somehow over the last 10 years or so, suddenly has become such an important part of the extractive industry. And I think we need to situate the conversation, therefore, into what has changed and why there is such a demand for it. And so the point by Patrick about the fact that local people are asking for some contribution or a stake in the newly found oil industry is legitimate, because it's based on a particular logic and a particular experience that actually the continent has not benefited from its rich resources. And we recognize that companies are making the profits, and through the global value chain actually are shifting also their profits around through subsidiaries and all of that. And I think that countries and communities feel that it is about time for our communities and our countries to actually begin to gain some benefits, not just simply paying some pittance to communities, but actually concretely, so that after the mines, after the extractive industries have exhausted the minerals, they can survive. And so I think that it's useful to situate the conversation within that context. And also I'll link that to the fact that over the last few years, there's not a convergence that one, that African countries have not benefited from their resources. Two, that the hemorrhage of financial resources, illicit financial flows, essentially, from the continent, is bleeding the continent, right? And therefore, there's need to address that. And part of government's response, in my judgment, is that is to then begin to connect local economies. In part, it's also because the extractive sector is removed from the broader economy. So an attempt to reconnect the broader economy to the industry. And I think that if we should situate it within that context so that it's not just simply as if it's an imposition, but it's actually a response to a particular need. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, I need to move on because otherwise they cut us off. So I apologize if I cannot capture some more comments from the floor. What I'm going to do is give the floor to all of you in the same order that you spoke and to react to the questions as you see them very, very briefly, and then I conclude. So Isabel, please.
Yes, I'll try to do it in 2 minutes. I think I totally agree. This conversation is part of a broader discussion. We are talking here about local content, which is a very specific, if you want, type of policy, but it is not totally disconnected from the broader economic transformation debate that we are having, which includes downstream beneficiation, but also linking the extractive sector with the other sector of the economy. That's what Patrick was mentioning. You have a finite resource that is going to expire at some point in time, and you need to make sure that you manage to shift out of it. The other thing that Anna mentioned, I think this is very important, the question of partnerships. Government cannot do it alone. And companies, you are there for 50 years. So as he was saying, you are in the face of the communities. So the question of partnerships is extremely important. And maybe just to end on one thing that I wanted to mention about what Kwesi was asking about the reason why this thing picked up. At some point, people were focusing a lot on the revenue dimension. Let us get royalties and taxes and try to invest, blah, blah, blah. That has not obviously worked, at least to the extent of what was expected. The new, to me, alternative to this, then, is how do you do it differently to achieve the same result? The local content has been one of the responses that we've seen over the years because the revenue argument was not selling enough well. So to me, we can discuss about why that came up, political, economic, rationale, etc. But there is also the legacy of the way many countries have tried to leverage their extractive resources with different forms of policies. Probably in 5 years or 10 years from now, there will be something that we're not thinking about, which is the local content beast with another name. But that's, to me, in the process of how do you make sure that you transform your resources?
Thank you. Well, I think in a way it's this national strategies, or that you call them national industrial programs, but it's in that direction. Babajit?
Yeah, thank you very much. I think I will just conclude on the elements of, yes, once we agree that it's a legitimate policy objective, that is something useful and of value for the country and the policymakers to do, then just as Anna said, then there should be a conversation on how effectively to do it. Because at the end of the day, local content policy that is just merely on paper or that does not achieve its objective is completely pointless or useless to the government. So yes, the government is interested in engaging with the stakeholders, including the community, including the larger private sector, as well as the company itself, in terms of let's see how to effectively implement this local content policy in a way that at least everybody benefits somewhat.
I'll try to conglomerate my answers. Normally, when you decide how to invest, it's alignment with the government. So I'm following the question on whether what we invest in infrastructure is focused for development. Well, it does depend how the government agree on what we do things. It's a huge investment on infrastructure. And if the government wants us to focus on a specific requirements and then give a different donation for the local development funds, then it's the communities that use those funds for infrastructure. So I must say that this depends pretty much on the government. On your question on how to convince other companies to get engaged, I don't think we are in the best moment. The market is terrible. Mineral prices are low. So governments are on the weak side. Companies are looking for the low-hanging fruits or the highest quality with the lowest cost. It is on where we are on equal terms. That, let's say, the normal transition. And second point is, you are having much more international pressure. We have a lot, most of our pressure on our sustainability investors, sustainable investors, are putting us a lot of a higher threshold. There are institutions of, such as EITI, which we work with to align with communities. I think right now, the communities are also putting a lot of pressure in government and companies. Literally, if we don't align with communities, they do not let us operate. So the government might let us operate, but a community does not let you operate. So there are many elements.
Thank you, Anna. Patrick, very
Yeah, very mine's quickly. Going to be, I think I'll keep on the same track. We are now living in a global village. What happens, as has been said, on prices will impact all the way down to production at a local level. So we're all linked. And if you're talking about a conversation in terms of monetization of resources, it is not a simple conversation. Local content is just one of the ways of monetization or getting revenue back into the system. There's a whole host of others. People are expecting cash. There's taxes. There's a whole series of items that are there in terms of getting back from the resources. Some of them, which has been cash in the past, have been sent out and have never reached the people who it's required to reach. And hence, they've been building sort of kind of systems to ensure that that happens. So I think that listening to what has been said, papers and papers from being written in Indonesia and people having conversations, those conversations are peripheral. They don't actually address the core issue. And I think everybody has to come around the table and agree on what needs to be addressed and who needs to address it and then move from there. It's not about making policies. It's not about holding people accountable. It's not about pointing fingers. I think you need to have an honest conversation at the center, and then everybody contributes their bit to making it happen. Local content is a great way of doing it, but I think there's a whole host of other areas that need to be looked at the same time to actually get the best outcome out of the extractives and the resources that we have. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Patrick, and thank you all of you. As you see, we have chosen this policy tool of local content to really tease and start a conversation on what you can see. It's a very complex subject. Now, what is very interesting is how our panelists, coming from very different perspectives, really, you can say, agree on the general message here, which is the need to ensure that extractive industries generate sustainable development at the end of the day. And that how we do it, that's the key question. And how do we work with the global frameworks on trade and investment policy to address the local and the national concerns? That's really the biggest challenge. Looking forward, which is what we have been trying to do in the A15, there's much more that we didn't talk about here. There's the underinvestment in R&D in the mining industry. There are the new business models that are being now prompted by the low prices in the commodity markets and so on. There is also the transformation of the industry that would probably be pushed by policies that are looking for a low carbon and green and a green economy. So all the agreements of Paris of last week and so on, which may force big changes as well in the industry. So we're just in time, I think, to try to intervene in these topics with recommendations on those global frameworks on trade and investment. I'll close here. I think we're a bit late, and I apologize for that. Thank you all very much.